got a little drama. Kissed in a field of white, stars fell on Alabama last night. Well, I can't forget the glamour. Your eyes held a tender light, and stars fell on Alabama night. I never planned in my imagination a situation so heavenly, a fairy land where no one else could enter, yet in the center just you and me, dear. My heart be like a hammer, my arms wound around you tight, and the stars fell on Alabama last night. While those stars fell on Alabama last night.
Hello friends, this week we're working on the 1934 composition Stars Fell on Alabama. The title of this song actually dates back to an 1833 meteor shower in Alabama, and there was a book written about that, and that's where the title of this comes from, about the night that the stars fell on Alabama. But this was composed as a beautiful, beautiful love ballad, had a major hit with Louis Armstrong, of course, and even she and him, or Zoe Deschanel and M. Ward, recorded this just a few years back on their classics album. I was really happy to hear this tune on here. What I want to talk about is actually some of the harmony that's in here and explain why it works, because a lot of these chords are fairly simple. There's many progressions that we've seen, and then there's a few curveballs thrown in here. So if we look at the A section, we start off with our 1-6-2-5 progression, all dominant chords. Now this is a very typical voicing. We have B flat 6th to G 7th. There's one note difference. We're making the B flat now a B, and that walks us right up to our C 7th to F. So this is a nice little circle progression that we've all heard hundreds and hundreds of times before. Now if this, it resolves right back where we want it to, to a B flat sixth chord. But what happens after this is a little bit funky. We go to a D minor seventh and then to a D diminished chord. And we ask ourselves where these two chords came from. Now, D minor seventh makes sense in the key of B flat, but it's not one of our more common choices as the three chord. It's a very weak harmonic element. But if we look ahead, we're going now to a C minor seventh. And what we can think of is these two chords in the context of going to that C minor seventh chord. In this, the D minor seventh becomes the two chord in the key of C minor. And this D diminished chord, if we look at it, it's A flat, D, F, and B. Now, if we just take the first finger and move it so the G string's open, we magically have a G seventh chord here, which is our dominant chord, leading us to the C minor seventh. But the reason we use the D diminished here is if we look at the melody, there's actually a walk down from an A to an A flat in the melody. So while we're voicing this dominant chord, this G seventh, we're putting an A flat in there as well to help highlight the movement of the melody. So we have this nice passage that goes and leads our ear directly to that C minor seventh, which is functioning again as the two chord. Now in the key of B flat, we just have a 2-5-1, C minor seventh, F seventh, right to B flat sixth. So despite having these two sort of off color chords in here, they really do work quite well in leading the ear harmonically to our 2-5-1 in our dominant key. Now we repeat the A section again, but then if we look at the bridge, there's a few little things going on here, and really this is a very simple circle that we're using. If we look at the first two bars, we have C minor seventh, F seventh, and then we have that D minor seventh to D diminished seventh again, and you'd guess right, it goes right back to that C minor seventh. It's harmonically acting exactly the same. We repeat the 2-5-1, the C minor seventh to F seventh, but this time we let ourselves just resolve nicely to the B flat sixth, and walk up to the G7th. A nice nod back to that 1-6-2-5 progression in the beginning. Now here's where things get just a little bit odd. We repeat the 2-5 again, C minor 7th, F 7th, and go to G minor 7th. And this is what we call a deceptive cadence. Instead of going back to our tonic chord where that F 7th is leading our ear, we're going to the relative minor in that key. If you think about G minor and B flat major are actually identical keys. So we're going up to this G minor 7th. It makes total sense in the progression. If you're not quite hearing the tonality of that since it's a 7th chord and thus the same as a B flat 6th, you play regular G minor here and that'll highlight more the minor tonality of this. Now what we're going to here is kind of cool. From this G minor 7th, we go down to the 6th chord in the key of G, where our E minor 7th, which is also functioning as a 3 chord. We have a 3-6-2-5, but there's something off here when we get to the E minor 7th. We get to an E minor 7th, and then an A 7th, and we can think of this as an A 9 because of the melody tones here. We have a B to a C sharp. E minor 7th sounds a little bit off. We don't get that in the key of B flat, right? So what we're doing is we're stepping out of the key for a moment and we're going to that key of G, but G major, not G minor. This E minor 7th to A 7th, and then we have a D 7th. Now we already said that we would traditionally play a D minor 7th. That's our 3 chords. We have this dominant 3 chord, but it's acting as our dominant in the key of G. So we're temporarily modulating to the key of G just a little bit in this little section here. After we hit the G minor 7th chord, we're modulating to G major for 1.5 bars in here. So we have E minor 7th to A 7th, and then we have this D 7th. And where does this D 7th fit getting us to the F 7th? And while it sounds jarring, because we have an F sharp in the melody, we walk down do chromatically here. What's cool is if we look at an F 7th, we have A, E flat, F, and C, right? Those are our notes that we're playing in order in our F 7th chord. As we go to the D 7th before this, we see that we still have the A, we still have the C, but we have a D and an F sharp in the middle now. This D moves up to an E flat. The F sharp moves down to an F natural, giving us common tones in the outer voicings. So this doesn't sound too jarring when we go to the F 7th, and then what we call contrary motion to get from the D on the inner voices to the F 7th. So that's why this D 7th chord can work very well here to get us where we would traditionally want to hear kind of a C minor 7th here. It doesn't support the melody. And in using this D 7th, we create this nice tension and then harmonic release when we get to the dominant, which brings us right back to our B flat 6th to finish out the last A section. It's important to look at tunes and why we play the chords we play and how they function in context. It's important to start to understand music so that we can see similarities between tunes and start to figure out our own harmonic movement between different chords. I'll see y'all next week.